Good morning everyone and welcome to JFD's daily market review for February the 21st. I am Charalambos Pissouros, senior market analyst here at JFD, and I will talk about yesterday's main market movers, what's my opinion moving ahead, what are today's important events, and how they could affect the markets. But before we start, let's read our disclaimer. The content we produce does not constitute investment advice or investment recommendation, should not be considered as such, and does not in any way constitute an invitation to acquire any financial instrument or product. I will leave you a few seconds to read the rest, and then we will jump into our analysis. Okay, today I will talk about the change in market sentiment as fears over the coronavirus returned into the markets. I will also talk about the yen, which continued to slide despite the risk of environment and perhaps due to concerns with regards to Japan's economic performance. What's more, today we have the preliminary PMIs from the Eurozone, the UK and the US, so we may get a first taste of how the virus have impacted the global economic outlook. And as for the rest of today's events, we have Eurozone's final CPIs for January, Canada's retail sales for December. We have four speakers on the agenda, while over the weekend we have a G20 finance leaders meeting, where I believe that we may get discussions over the virus. Now, as always, let's start with the dollar's performance. The greenback continued trading higher against most of the other G10 currencies on Thursday and during the Asian morning Friday. It gained the most against the Kiwi, the Aussie and the Yen in that order, while it slightly underperformed only against the Swiss franc. The greenback was found virtually unchanged versus the euro. Now, the weakening of the commodity-linked currencies and the strengthening of the dollar and the franc suggest that the risk appetite eased yesterday. However, the extension of the yen's tumble raises questions on that front, and thus we will turn our gaze to the equity and the bond markets in order to get a clearer picture. Major EU and US indices, as well as the German and the US 10-year yields, traded in negative waters, with the subdued investor morale rolling into the Asian morning today. Although China's Shanghai composite gained 0.19%, Japan's 0.31%, not 0.19%, Japan's Nikkei 225, Hong Kong's Hang Seng, and South Korea's KOSPI slid 0.39%, 1.19% and 1.49% respectively. Now, once again, news surrounding the coronavirus dominated the broader market sentiment. Despite China reporting a slowdown in both deaths and infected cases for Wednesday, yesterday South Korea announced its first death from the virus, while the infected cases within the country accelerated. What's more, two passengers in the Diamond Princess cruise ship in Japan, hit by the virus, died, while later in the day, Global Times reported that a hospital in central Beijing announced 36 new cases, adding that among them were medical workers. Now, as for the total number of cases and deaths worldwide for Thursday, we are back in acceleration mode. You can see the graphs I'm posting every day. And you can see that the blue line is back above zero. Remember that above zero, anything above zero points to acceleration, while a negative reading points to a slowdown. Now, remember that yesterday morning we noted that with scientists saying that the virus may spread more easily than previously believed, we cannot rule out the number of cases to start accelerating again. And the overnight reports confirm our view. Despite many equity indices hitting new records recently, we will maintain our cautious stance and we will stick to our guns that the risks surrounding the market reaction to fresh news may be asymmetrical and tilted to the downside. Anything pointing to the virus getting out of control again may have a larger negative impact than any positive response due to soothing headlines. Now, with China announcing that the vaccine will be submitted for clinical trials around late April, the fastest, we continue seeing the case of the economic wounds of the world's second largest economy dragging into the second quarter. Further stimulus measures by Chinese authorities may have diminishing effects in supporting economic activity going forward, as restrictions and fears may prevent consumers from spending. Now, coming back to the currencies, the yen seems to have taken off its safe haven suit and continued tumbling against the majority of its peers, despite other safe havens like bonds, the US dollar, and the Swiss franc attracting flows. Gold was also among the beneficiaries, with the precious metal rallying to levels last seen in February 2013. With no clear catalyst behind the extension of the yen's tumble, it seems that participants may have continued selling the currency on fears over Japan's economic performance. Remember that on Monday, data showed that the world's third largest economy contracted during the last 3 months of 2019, and with the coronavirus expected to have left its marks in the first quarter, the nation may be headed towards a recession. What's more, data overnight showed that Japanese inflation stood well below the Bank of Japan's 2% target in January, adding to concerns over the economic performance. However, if investors and traders are willing to continue selling the currency, they may prove Japan's saviors, as something like that could help inflation and exports, at least during the last month of the first quarter. Now, as for today, the spotlight is likely to fall to preliminary PMIs for February, as investors are sitting on the edge of their seats in anticipation of finding out whether and how much did the coronavirus hurt the global economy. The day starts with the numbers from several Eurozone nations and the bloc as a whole. Here we already got a first taste from the disappointing German ZEW survey on Tuesday. However, investors may rely more on what the PMIs will show for the whole euro area. The manufacturing PMI is forecast to have stayed in contractionary territory for the 13th month in a row, sliding to 47.5 from 47.9. The services index is also forecast to have slid, but to still signal expansion. Specifically, it is expected to have declined to 52.2 from 52.5. Now, all this will drive the composite index down to 51 from 51.3. Now, at the press conference following the latest ECB decision, President Lagarde repeated that the risks to the economic outlook are still tilted to the downside, but less pronounced, as surveys and data still point to some stabilization. A modest slide in the PMIs is unlikely to make her change that view, but a larger than expected decline may raise concerns over the impact of the virus on the bloc's economy. This could add further pressure to the already wounded euro, as some investors may start betting on more rate cuts by the ECB. That said, our own view is that given the bank's limited scope for further easing, officials may not rush into doing so, even if the PMIs disappoint. After all, an extension of the euro's latest tumble may eventually prove somewhat supportive for the bloc's economy, as it may give a helping hand to inflation and exports. Although the ECB has clearly stated several times that it does not target the exchange rate, a lower euro may be a welcome development for policymakers and may alleviate some pressure for additional stimulus, at least in the months to come. Now, we get preliminary PMIs for February from the UK as well. The manufacturing PMI is forecast to have returned to contractionary territory, sliding to 49.7 from 50, while the services index is expected to have declined to 53.4 from 53.9 in January. The pound was found lower against the US dollar this morning, despite yesterday's better-than-expected retail sales data for January. It seems that market participants may be waiting for the PMIs to adjust their bets on whether the Bank of England will cut rates or not in the months to come. Now, later in the day, we get even more PMIs, this time from the US. The preliminary market manufacturing index is forecast to have declined to 51.5 from 51.9, while the services one is anticipated to have held steady at 53.4. There is no forecast for the composite index, but in any case, market participants tend to pay more attention to the ISM PMIs, which are scheduled to be released on March the 2nd and 4th. Now, apart from the PMIs from the Eurozone, we also get the final CPIs for January, but as it is always the case, they are expected to confirm the initial estimates, namely that the headline CPI rate ticked up to 1.4 year over year from 1.3%, and that the core one slid to 1.1% from 1.3%. Now, from Canada, we get retail sales for December, with the headline rate anticipated to have fallen to 0.2% month over month from 0.9%, and the core one to have risen to 0.4% from 0.2%. Despite a potential slowdown in headline sales, a rising core rate, especially following the acceleration in inflation on Wednesday, may distance further Bank of Canada policymakers from the easing button. We also have four speakers on our agenda: ECB Executive Board Member Philip Lane, Fed Vice Chair Richard Clarida, Fed Board Governor Lyle Brainard, and Cleveland Fed President Loretta Mester. Now, as for the weekend, finance leaders of the G20 nations will meet in Saudi Arabia's capital, with the main topic perhaps being the coronavirus outbreak. So that's it from me. Thank you very much for watching and listening. I hope you have a great weekend, and I'm looking forward to seeing you here again next week. For those who are interested in learning about the main events of the week much earlier, you can subscribe to the weekly Market Outlook webinar, which I'm holding every Monday at 8 o'clock a.m. GMT time. You can find the link in the description below. So goodbye from me, and have a great weekend.